Good afternoon, my name is Tavia.
And my name is Brooke.
And we are thrilled to collaborate with Evergreen Assisted Living to provide this education on diabetes and oral health. We believe interprofessional collaboration is vital to improving our patients' quality of care, and we thank you for the opportunity.
People with diabetes know the disease can harm the eyes, nerves, kidneys, heart, and other important systems in the body. But did you know diabetes can also cause problems in the mouth? In this video, we are going to discuss the link between blood sugar and the oral environment, and also common oral conditions associated with diabetes and how you can recognize and prevent them. The first topic we would like to start with is blood sugar. We know controlling blood sugar is a matter of life or death for some patients with diabetes, but just how important is blood sugar to the oral environment? As it turns out, it is very important. When a patient's blood sugar is high, their white blood cells become sluggish and are unable to clean up bacteria in a timely manner. Once an infection sets in, the body starts a stress response by increasing the amount of hormones such as cortisol and adrenaline. These hormones work against the action of insulin, and as a result, the body will produce more blood glucose, resulting in higher levels of blood sugar. As you can see, this becomes a very difficult cycle to break, which is why controlling blood sugar is so important in patients with diabetes. Now that you understand how blood sugar and infection control are related, let's move on to the oral environment.
If you have diabetes, it can affect parts of your body. This includes your teeth and gums. The effect is even greater when your blood sugar is not well controlled, making it harder to fight bacterial infections. Plaque is a clear, sticky layer of bacteria that forms on the teeth. If it is not removed, it can lead to infections such as gum disease. If your high blood sugar is not controlled, you may have more plaque bacteria than most people. That means you are more at risk for oral health problems. Gingivitis is a form of gum disease. It is caused by a buildup of plaque and tartar on the teeth and gums. If you have diabetes, it is harder for your body to control plaque bacteria. That is why people with diabetes are 3 to 4 times more likely to get gum disease. If gingivitis is left untreated, it may turn into periodontitis. Periodontitis is a more complex disease. Over time, bacteria infects the jawbone, causing the bone to deteriorate and the gums to pull away from the teeth. This loss of bone can cause the tooth to become loose. Blood sugar and gum disease go hand in hand. Gum disease is a risk factor for uncontrollable blood sugar, just as uncontrollable blood sugar is a risk factor for gum disease. Proper oral hygiene will protect oral health as well as manage diabetes. The easiest way to decrease plaque in the mouth is by brushing. Proper brushing technique is necessary for adequate plaque removal. Today we will be discussing the bass method. This method should be used on all patients as it thoroughly cleans the teeth of all plaque. First, hold the toothbrush sideways against the teeth when some of the soft bristles touching the gums. Tilt the brush at a 45 degree angle pointing toward the gum line. Move the toothbrush in an up and down motion. The top arch and bottom arch should be separated into 3 sections when brushing. Clean one section in the up and down motion for 10 seconds and continue to the next section. Continuously move the brush in massaging the gum line. Make sure to get the inside portion of all the teeth. When applying toothpaste, add 2 millimeters onto the soft bristle brush and brush for 2 minutes twice a day. After brushing, store the toothbrush in a dry area separated from any other toothbrushes.
Another important part of plaque removal is flossing. Brushing alone can only clean the front and back surfaces of the teeth. The side surfaces in between teeth and the underlying gum tissue is cleaned using floss. To begin, wind about 18 inches of floss around your middle fingers. Allow one finger to unwind a clean piece of floss and the other to wind a dirty piece of floss after using. Next, use your thumb and index fingers to guide about 1 inch of floss between each tooth. Gently saw the floss between each tooth, then curve into a C shape around one side of the tooth and then the other, allowing the floss to gently slide underneath the gum tissue. Continue sliding the floss up and down and around each tooth. Repeat until all teeth on the upper and lower jaw are completed. Dry mouth is a common symptom of diabetes. Having dry mouth, especially with diabetes, can lead to increased plaque retention and rampant tooth decay. As blood sugar increases, the body continuously tries, but fails, to fight infection. Dry mouth can also lead to an altered sense of taste or leave a metallic, sour taste in the mouth. It is important to check the side effects of all medications, as dry mouth often appears. As healthcare providers, we encourage our patients to stay hydrated by drinking plenty of water and stimulate saliva flow by chewing sugar-free gum, sucking on mints with xylitol, or using a moisturizing mouth rinse such as biotin. Adequate saliva flow is the mouth's number one defense to bacteria. As seen in these photographs, people who suffer from dry mouth may experience chapped lips, sores at the corner of their mouth, or a dry, fissured tongue. These symptoms may not only be painful, but also create environments desirable for infection.
One of the infections caused by dry mouth is called thrush and seems to be more common in patients with diabetes. Thrush is caused by Candida fungus, which is also known as yeast. Yeast is present in the mouth in a small amount, but when the balance gets offset, the fungus can grow and cause thrush. The most common sign of thrush is seeing creamy white lesions in your mouth, usually on the tongue, cheeks, or on the roof of the mouth. The appearance may remind you of cottage cheese. The major risk factor for the development of this condition is wearing an upper complete denture, particularly when it's not removed during sleep and cleaned regularly. Older dentures are more likely to be involved, so reminding your patients to remove their dentures as much as possible is critical to preventing this infection. Next, we're going to give you some helpful tips on how to properly care for dentures.
When caring for dentures, you may want to lay a towel on the counter or partially fill the sink with water so that they won't break if you drop them. You'll want to clean the dentures after every meal and just before bed. Start by rinsing them underwater to remove any food debris off of them. Rinsing alone does not remove plaque from dentures, and they will need to be brushed. Use a denture brush for brushing dentures. The intufted side is used for clasp and the part of the denture that touches the gums. The flat toothbrush side is used for the teeth. Do not use toothpaste on dentures, as it is too abrasive and can scratch them, which will harbor bacteria. When brushing dentures, you don't want to grasp them too tightly because you can distort or even break them. Use warm water and a non-abrasive cleanser, like liquid dish soap, when brushing dentures. Next, rinse the denture and brush under running water and use the brush to get all the soap off the denture. Check each area for any plaque left on. It will feel slippery and not squeaky clean if plaque is still on. Dentures need to be soaked at night to keep from distorting. Use room temperature water and a cleanser in a container with a lid. If the water is too warm, it can distort the denture. Be sure that the entire denture is submerged in the solution. Rinse the dentures before giving them back to the patient.
In conclusion, we have discussed the effect of blood sugar on oral health, the relationship of diabetes and gum disease, how to effectively brush using the BASS technique, how to effectively floss using the curved C method, the relationship between diabetes and xerostomia, the common fungal infections and the characteristics involved with each, and how to properly care for a denture.
Thank you for your time and effort to improve the quality of healthcare for your patients.